Chapter 13, Vision On, The Use and Abuse of Visual Aids. None of the greatest speakers in history have needed a visual aid. That includes you. If you have something worthwhile to say, if you write it clearly and expressively, and deliver it with variety and conviction, you are all the visual aid which you need. For many years, one of Britain's most compelling speakers was the historian A.J.P. Taylor. He built up a massive following on television, yet all he did was lecture straight to the camera. The power of his thoughts and words was quite enough. The basic point about all visual aids is that they should be the servants of your speech, not its master. The better the visual aids, the more risk that they will dictate the structure and content of the speech. The temptation is strongest with PowerPoint and its competitors, and I have listened to many speeches where the speaker has just become an oral accompaniment to the slides. An allied problem with visual aids is that they can actually limit your audience's imagination. And again, the better the visual aid, the higher the risk. People receive information in very different ways. They have unique personal translation systems of the words they hear from outside into data and ideas which they can use from inside. Some will translate them into a visual image, some will not. And for those that do, each visual image will be different. To take a simple example, suppose that you mention a series of statistics, 10%, 17%, 35%. Immediately, you flash up a visual aid. The conventional wisdom is that percentages show up best with the pie chart. So you use an elegant, well-marked chart with all the right slices of pie. But not everyone in the audience sees percentages as pie slices. For some people, percentages are jelly beans, 10 red, 17 yellow, 35 green. Others are more focused on the relationship of the percentages. They might mentally see a bar chart, not a pie chart, with a 10 high bar and a 17 high bar and a towering 35 high bar. Still others assimilate percentages directly, with no visual cue. For all of those impious people, the pie chart adds nothing to their understanding and may even impede it. Another point about your audience is that many people, especially in academic settings, tape record speeches. They cannot tape record something visual. There are more practical problems with visual aids. The most obvious is that they are visual. They make you learn another language to do with colors and shapes and spatial relationships and symbols and icons and typography and what people can see at the back. Visual aids are about adding something to spoken words, and you add nothing to spoken words just by displaying them. During the 1950s, lots of low-budget sci-fi movies featured a scene in which the invariably male scientist would say to the female assistant, "The only possible explanation is that we are being invaded by gamma-ray carrots from Mars." She would gasp, "You mean blank?" And he would say, "Yes, let me show you on the screen." He would then switch on a screen showing the words, "Gamma Ray Carrots, Mars." If you want to avoid this trap in your visual aids, you must become not only a writer, but an illustrator. All visual aids require extra preparation and expense and mastery of complex high-tech equipment, such as a blackboard or flip chart. Drawing on a blackboard and exposing the right page in a flip chart are expert skills. They need setting up and rehearsal. If you hand something out for the audience to keep up, you have to bring enough of them. If you hand something out for them to pass round and examine, you have to make sure that you get it back and not broken or grubby. Visual aids are so many extra things to go wrong and to get anxious about. For all these reasons, it is very tempting to declare yourself an A.J.P. Taylor and do without them. However, used rightly, they are a valuable extra resource. They can make an audience remember the things you want remembered, and they can give key passages a unique additional impact. In some circumstances, a visual aid is more than an aid. It is actually integral to understanding a speech. If you are talking about an artist or an actor or a sports person, you need illustrations of his or her work or him or her in action, About a movie or TV show, you need clips from it. About a battle, you need a battle plan, and almost certainly you will gain from a battle plan in sequence. If you are talking about any sort of unfamiliar place, from 18th century London to the planet Mercury, you certainly need a map, and almost certainly you will gain from zooming in and out of detail. In some cases, you may want or need an aural aid rather than a visual one. In a speech about music, you may want to use tapes or possibly a piano or guitar. I would not advise you to compete against a live orchestra. There are other speeches where a sound cue might be appropriate. For example, an extract from a radio broadcast or an advertising jingle. Exactly the same principles apply as to visual aids. If a visual aid has this much importance in your speech, you need to incorporate it into all your planning and writing. If the aid is going to be permanently on view, say a map, you need to explain it early on. The three R's. If you decide to use visual aids or sound, remember the three R's. Be relevant, be rational, be ruthless. Be relevant. Do not use any image or sound which are not totally integrated into your speech. Do not use any which might take attention away from your speech, which might make the audience think about, or worse, still remember, things you did not intend to tell them. Do not use images and sounds for incidental entertainment. Be rational. Use images or sounds which accurately convey the information you want your audience to have. Be ruthless. Images and sound work best in small quantities. Use them very sparingly and shut them off the second they achieve their effect. Even if they are relevant and rational, do not use images or sounds which add nothing to the effect of your words. One of the most irritating features of television news is the pointless image caused by the compulsion of television to illustrate. If there is a story about dairy farming, up comes the library footage of Daisy the cow. Now let us go back to Chapter 4 on speech architecture and look at the plan on page 36 for the speech on the Metropolitan Police. 1. Crime in London, early 19th century. A. High crime areas, paired with Visual 1, Map of London, 1825. B. Social problems, paired with V2, Print, Gin Drinker. C. Organized crime, paired with Visual 3, Print, Bill Sykes. 2. Policing in London. D. Private patrols. E. Peel in government, paired with Visual 4, Cartoon, Peel. F. Metropolitan Police, founded 1829, paired with Visual 5, Print, Peeler in uniform. The speaker lists 5 visual aids. The first one, the map of 19th century London, is relevant and informative. Since the speaker is likely to mention London places throughout the speech, the map should be permanently on view where the speaker can point to it. The second, the image of the gin drinker, will add nothing to the speaker's description of social problems in London and will actually hinder the audience's memory of social problems other than alcohol. The third image, Dickens's Bill Sykes, will also add nothing to the words, and why make the audience think about a fictional criminal instead of a real one? The fourth image, Peel, is marginal. It is relevant and rational, and it may help the audience to remember a now obscure historical figure. But is he really needed? The police are the story, not Peel. The fifth image, an early Metropolitan policeman in uniform, is worth keeping. It will help the audience to understand and remember important information about the subject of the speech. The three R's have stripped out 3 unnecessary images, saved the speaker time and anxiety, and produced the maximum effect from the survivors. The art of elimination. An effective visual aid conveys information accurately and without waste. An image achieves this not by what it shows, but by what it leaves out. In a great work of art, every detail is part of the artist's plan, and anything not part of the plan is eliminated. You are a great artist, and your approach should be the same. The first thing to eliminate from any image is words. You are already using words in your speech. Your image should not need them. It should contain only the words needed to identify what the image is about. For example, labeling everything illustrated in a chart or diagram. If you do not own the image, you will also have to include identification of the copyright owner. There is a very practical as well as a logical reason for eliminating words in an image. You want the audience to see them. With this in mind, take it on trust from me that you have at most 25 words to play with in a visual aid. In a chart or diagram, you will need most, if not all of them, for essential labeling of its individual components. If you have any words left over, use them to deliver a key message rather than simply labeling the whole image. For example, instead of saying Exports by Region 1999, you might say EU Largest Market in 1999. Having wiped out all unnecessary words, you must now eliminate any unnecessary image. Kill at once any cute little cartoon character or clip art. Eliminate your organization's logo. In a photograph, crop any unnecessary detail. In a chart or diagram, represent visually only the things you want to talk about. In the chart of Exports by Region 1999, you might not want to represent all the world's regions. Perhaps the only significant ones in your speech are the EU, North America, and the Far East. In that case, do not show the other regions at all, unless for some reason you are making a percentage comparison, in which case you can collapse all the rest into a single entry for others. A good visual aid will not be too crowded. People absorb visual information best when it stands out against blank space. For the same reason, eliminate any cutesy tricks with lettering, fonts, shadows, 3D effects, letters appearing and disappearing, and eliminate pointless, distracting color and graphic effects. As we have noted, although a font with serifs is easier for you to read in manuscript, a sans serif font is better for a visual aid. Types of visual aid. Here are a few notes on the strengths and weaknesses of different types of visual aids in the approximate order of their invention. Every one of them needs careful planning and rehearsal to make it work at its best. Maps, including hypothetical maps, battle plans, etc. Strengths, genuine, often essential aid to understanding. Potential weaknesses, visibility of all details to all audience, zoom in for special features, needs technology. If unfamiliar place, needs clear indication of scale, not just numbers, but comparator familiar to audience, for example, New York to Washington, D.C. Exhibit, a physical example, replica, or model of the thing you were actually talking about. For example, Aztec artifact, teddy bear, scale model of Titanic. Strengths, exceptional audience interest, accuracy of information. Potential weaknesses, if present constantly, may distract audience. May be hard to hold up exhibit and talk from notes or text at the same time. May be hard for all audience to see exhibit, which may need to be passed around. If so, leave this until after your speech. If passed, risk of damage or theft. Tell audience which way you want it passed. Photographs. A photograph has much the same strengths and weaknesses as an exhibit. It is interesting and accurate, but it may be hard to see, and if it is permanently on view, it may distract your audience from your speech. Unlike an exhibit, a photograph can be cropped and edited to remove extraneous details. This has been done so frequently in the modern age for faking and propaganda that you may feel slightly uncomfortable doing this yourself. If there is any chance that your audience might spot your editing, for example, because you are using a very familiar photograph, do not do it, because it will inspire mistrust. Like all images, a photograph is potentially copyright. Check that you have the right to use it. Diagram or chart or graph. Strengths can be made in advance. A diagram is an excellent way to illustrate complex objects or processes. Rules and conventions of charts, if observed, can help most audiences absorb information by giving early indication of the type of information being conveyed. For example, a pie chart for percentages, a bar chart for comparison of magnitudes, time moving from left to right on a graph. Potential weaknesses: risk of clutter and irrelevant information. Very hard for audience to take notes. Risk of percentages not adding up to 100%, which will infuriate some audience members. Some audiences may not take in information through conventions. Because charts and graphs are schematic, there is a special need to make them transparent and honest. It is very easy to play tricks with scale and slope and starting lines, which can completely change the presentation of information. For example, you can make falling sales look like a small temporary blip if you were the CEO, or a dramatic plunge if you were an angry shareholder. If anyone in your audience spots that you have used a specious presentation in a chart or graph, it will inspire mistrust in you and your speech. Slides. High-quality slides have more impact than photographs, but of course, they require a projector and a darkened room, and Murphy's familiar law will ensure that at least some of them will be in the wrong order or upside down. Slides are no help to audience members who want to tape, record your speech, or even take notes. They also automatically slow down your speech and risk taking it over altogether. See photographs. Blackboard. Plus modern counterpart, the felt tip board. Strengths: easy to use. Felt tip more than blackboard. Nothing to go wrong. You can add and subtract during speech. Create simple, memorable information. Create automatic suspense for audience as they wonder what you were writing. Allow audience time to catch up on notes. Potential weaknesses: they take time. Reduce this by putting diagrams or sketch plans, etc. on board in advance, and write only words during speech. May be hard to read for audience. Yellow chalk on green board is easiest. Chalk and pens may squeak horribly. Your awful handwriting, your poor spelling. Flip chart. Strengths: much as for blackboard and felt board, can be prepared in advance, but still amended during speech. An effective way to convey simple, memorable information, especially good for any kind of process, automatic suspense and drama. What's under the blank page? Allows audience to take notes. Potential weaknesses: can be hard to see, especially for those at the back. Help them by leaving bottom third blank on each page. Risk of over detail: limit bullet points to 3 per page. Tearing too many pages or wrecking a page. You will have to learn the expert matador tear, a short, sharp tug at the corner. If you write, again, you risk exposing your awful handwriting and spelling. Writing on a flip chart needs to be at least 1.5 inches, 3.5 centimeters high, and even bigger if anyone is more than 30 feet, 9.1 meters away. This gives you terribly few words to play with, even with the big page. Use bold colors, not pastels. But remember that by convention, red still implies emphasis. Do not use only uppercase letters. If you are using a blackboard or felt board or flip chart, do not talk while you are writing and have your back to the audience. When you want to point to it, do not point across your body. In other words, use your nearest hand to the board. Audio tape. Strengths: obviously essential if you need to convey oral information. Always dramatic and interesting for audience. Allows time for note-taking. Potential weaknesses: needs reliable equipment, sound system. It is surprisingly easy to forget to introduce an audio section properly and suddenly switch on the tape. And obviously, you have to stop speaking and stand or sit still. Film or video clips. Strengths: drama, audience interest, and accuracy. Potential weaknesses: need equipment and darkened room. Stop your speech dead and may overshadow it. Overhead projector. Strengths: versatile and accurate. Can project anything which can be copied, but watch out for copyright. easy to prepare transparencies in advance and add them to your speech. Parts can be hidden by card for suspense. Transparencies can be laid on top of each other to show progress or add complexity. Can be used in lighted room by speaker facing audience at all times. Potential weaknesses: temperamental projectors, dust, or bad focus. Visibility: needs more rehearsal than any other medium. Too many words, cluttered details on transparencies. Too many transparencies overshadowing speaker, leaving transparency projected too long, distracting audience. PowerPoint and competitors. PowerPoint is a Microsoft software presentation package which you can use to create original material in almost any medium using both images and sound. It carries a big stock of clip art, images, fonts, letters, colors, and effects, but will also accept any internet or computer-generated material. It will accept movie images and will allow you to create animations and special effects. You can amend and re-amend your material. When you are finally satisfied with it, you can display this material on a computer or a projection system, disseminate it through the internet, and convert it to print. Strengths: accuracy, impact, and astonishing versatility. Potential weaknesses: simply too good and too easy. Too tempting to create amazing effects, or simply too many slides and forget to write a decent speech. May simply take over audiences' attention. Handouts. Handouts can be prepared in advance and can convey information to your audience in a lasting way. A handout may be anything from a book to a business card. The golden rule about handouts is not to hand them out until you have finished speaking. An audience will always look at a handout in preference to listening to you. It is simply human nature. And if your handout is too informative, the ruder members of your audience walk away with it and have a drink. There are a few exceptions to the principle of handing nothing out until after the speech. If you are going to be referring constantly to something in your speech, a map, or one particular text, you may want to give it out in advance. If, despite all your careful planning, your speech has an exceptionally complex structure, you may want to hand out a simplified plan of your speech to help your audience work out where you are. In that case, you must stick to that structure. Finally, you may sometimes want to hand out a full copy of your speech in advance to members of the media. If your speech is long, it is a courtesy to journalists who may have tight deadlines and will help you to be reported. If you do this, you must add the words "check against delivery" to the heading and include an embargo, not for publication before the speech has finished. Make certain there are enough handouts to go round. Audience members react like children at a birthday party if they miss a handout. Summary: visual and oral aids are never necessary, but used well, they can enrich your speech and make your key points memorable. Visual and oral aids should be the servants of your speech, not its master. Words are no better just for being displayed on a screen. Visual and oral aids have different strengths, weaknesses, and technical demands, but they all need careful planning and rehearsal. If you are planning to use any of them, make certain that your setting has the right equipment for them. Be relevant, rational, and ruthless in your use of visual and oral aids. Keep visual aids sparse and simple. Eliminate all unnecessary words and detail. Hand out no handout until you have finished speaking. Make certain there are enough to go round.